Three.
Hi, I'm Julie. Welcome to my macrobiotic kitchen. This is my friend Dave. He'll be filming us.
Yep. Okay, see you later. So what are we doing today, Julie?
Well, Dave.
I'll tell you. Sounds like a TV show.
Glad you asked that question.
Okay.
Today we are going to be making medium grain brown rice, lima beans, and vegetables, kale, and I'm going to be making a sauce with some parsley. Now, when you go into your macrobiotic kitchen, the first thing you need to do is put the food that will take the longest to cook on the stove right away. I've soaked this brown rice in water overnight. So 1 cup of brown rice, 2 cups of water, 1 to 2. Save the water and place the water and the rice in the pot. And when you are cooking, the best thing you can do is smell your food. So I'm going to just take a little sniff. Smell that, Dave.
Oh, it smells nice.
I know. It's very fresh smelling.
Now, some people will probably use a pressure cooker, right, to cook rice?
You can use a pressure cooker, or you can boil it, which I will be doing right now. A lot of people don't have pressure cookers, so I'm just going to start off by doing a simple method of cooking brown rice, such as this. Okay, I'm going to add some salt. For each cup of rice, add 1/8 teaspoon of sea salt.
Why sea salt?
Sea salt has a lot of minerals. Now, while that's cooking, I'm going to start to cook the beans. Today, I've soaked some lima beans overnight. Now, beans have a lot of gas, so I'm going to throw away this soaking water. I'm just going to throw this water away because it has a lot of gas in it.
What do you mean a lot of gas in it?
Creates a lot of foam, and when you'll see when I start to cook, foam will rise to the surface and I'll take that foam off. If you eat the foam, you get a lot of gas.
Okay.
It comes from the sugars. So right now I'm just going to put the beans in the pot. This will take about 45 minutes to an hour to cook. The rice will take about 50 minutes. So that's why we want to start this, the beans and the rice cooking right away. Once the beans are in the pot, I'm going to fill the pot with water and fill it to cover the beans so the beans are totally submerged under the water. About an inch above the top of the beans. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to add kombu sea vegetable. This is a sea vegetable that's high in minerals, and I've soaked the kombu, about a stamp-sized piece of kombu, overnight. And I'm going to put that with the beans to cook because the kombu helps to cook the beans. It makes the beans more digestible.
Do you use the kombu water?
No, throw away the kombu water because there are a lot of minerals in that water. And too many minerals is not good for you. So just the kombu is all you need. That has enough minerals in it. You don't need to add salt to the beans. right away. Because if you add salt, the beans will become hard. They won't cook all the way. So, turn the flame to high for the beans, and flame is on high for the rice. So we're just waiting for these to come to a boil. Once the rice has come to a boil, we can cover it and then lower the heat, cook for 50 minutes. Well, as we can see, I've been boiling the beans and the foam has risen to the surface. So now it's time to scoop the foam off. So I'm just gonna take a nice spoon here, put it in a bowl.
I always used to just mix the foam in, Julie. Why are you taking the foam off?
Well, this foam has a lot of gas in it. And if you eat this, you're gonna get some pain in your stomach. If you wanna get all of it, you would have to strain the beans out of the water and use new water. If you're very sensitive to foam, you can do that. You can actually just take it off the stove and strain the water off. That way you get all the foam and then put new water on.
Okay.
But I'm okay just scooping it off. So I'm done scooping. You see the kombu here is still there. Here's the kombu right here.
All right.
And I'm just going to turn down the heat here and let it simmer for about 45 minutes, and I'm gonna just put a cover, I'm gonna lightly cover it. Now, if the water starts to evaporate, just add more water. Make sure the beans are covered all the time. Now, let's start cooking our vegetables.
What do you do with that foam?
Well, I just throw it away.
Okay, so that has no use.
No, you don't use that.
All right.
I took a look at what we had in the refrigerator. We had some beautiful corn. This is the last corn of the season here, so I thought we would have that today. We have some scallions. Scallions is another word for green onion. This has upward growing energy here, which is very good for the heart because the energy goes upward, supports the upper part of the body. And here's some carrots. And as you know, I like to use the whole part of the plant. We won't be using the tops today, but save the tops for a soup or another dish. We'll be using the root, which is the carrot here, and we will support the lower part of our body. It's very grounding. Now the kale, leafy green, is very good for your heart because it has upward growing energy. It's best to have leafy greens such as kale or collard greens every day because we don't eat enough greens in this society. We need to open our heart up to be more open to love. And the same with parsley. Parsley is another leafy green. It's very good for the heart. These are, I've taken the leaves off of the plant already to prepare them for our sauce. So I think I want to ask Dave, what would you do with these vegetables? We are going to have greens as one of our dish. This is the sauce. How would you prepare our vegetables?
Well, my logical mind tells me that I would start with the things that were going to take the longest to cook.
What kind of dish would you make?
Oh, well, I'd make a dish with carrots, green onions, corn, kale, and parsley.
Oh, okay. You mean a hodgepodge.
Yeah, so you're probably going to do better than that.
Well, when you cook vegetables, it's always best to cook them so that they're more in harmony with each other instead of throwing them all together. If you are making a boiled vegetable dish with the carrots, I would boil the carrots separately from the corn. Mm-hmm. Because I would like the carrots to retain their individual flavor, their separate identity. If you cook them together, then they become one dish with one energy, which is another way of cooking. But boiled vegetables are great because when you eat a carrot, it's very sweet and it tastes like a carrot. And if you eat the corn, it's very sweet, it tastes like corn. And however, if you're making a stew, then you cook them together and the energies harmonize and it becomes one dish. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to make a boiled vegetable dish with the carrots and the corn. And what would you do with the scallions, Dave?
Okay, I think I know.
Well, go ahead. What were you
saying? All right, what I would do is I'd chop up the scallion really finely.
Yes.
And then I would mix it in with, after the beans were cooked, uh-huh. I would mix it with the beans.
Oh, that
sounds delicious. Some nice flavor.
Yeah, that sounds delicious.
Okay.
Why don't we do that?
All right.
I'm going to cut the scallions. Start from the top because this is the center right here. See, the roots are right here, and this is the center. Now, this is where the balance point is. The roots are growing down, and the green part is growing up. When we cut a vegetable, we cut toward the center. So we start cutting from the top toward the center, and when we use the root part, we cut toward the center.
Okay.
So I'm just going to start cutting very thinly. See?
Yep.
And I think maybe two scallions will be enough to season the lima beans.
Okay.
Hi, welcome back.
Well, it's nice to be back.
Now I'm going to cut the corn for our boiled salad.
Okay.
Now the way you cut corn is to cut it in half. And take a half, mm-hmm. hold it with your fingers, and cut lengthwise. If you cut the corn like this, which I see a lot of people doing, the corn tends to fly out.
Yeah.
And it's hard to control.
That's how I always do it. And you're right, corn goes flying all over. I never did it this way.
Now, if you cut when it's on the side, it will just... Because they're sticking together,
yep.
You'll see they'll be sticking together, and they just fall on the cutting board.
Oh, cool.
Okay, so hold your, curve your fingers so that you're not going to cut your fingers off. Because,
right.
Of course, if you're going like that, you know, that's not a good thing.
Right.
So, what you do is you start shaving off the kernels like that. See how they're stuck together?
Oh, my gosh, that is so cool.
And just, now, here's an idea. Since it's flat, put the flat side down. So it won't roll away. See that? Now, do not throw away the cob. The cob has a lot of the corn still attached. That's a lot of flavor. Now, what I always do is use the back of the knife and you can scrape off the extra corn. See that?
Yep.
Okay. Once you're done with the corn, save the cob and use it in your soup. Make a broth out of it. It has a lot of flavor and it's going to make your miso soup very sweet.
Okay.
Well, now Dave's going to try cutting.
He's up here.
Oh, hi Dave.
Okay. All right, now I'm going to try to do what Julie just did. I have never done this before. So I may cut my fingers off, we'll see.
Okay.
All right, here we go.
Wow, beautiful.
Nice.
See, it doesn't fly all over the place. See how he's curving his fingers? Wow, good job.
This is so much better than having the corn fly all over the kitchen.
I know. Now you can cut the vegetables next time.
Oh, well, I'm not that good at it.
Use the back of the knife to scrape off the extra corn.
I didn't know that either.
Yeah, and then save the cob. What would you do with your cobs?
Well, I have done some things with the cob, and so I do know. I put them in soup. I put them. I use them in stews. You know, just put them in until the flavor. Let the flavor just mix in. Sometimes you can just leave them in. I don't eat them, obviously, but sometimes they take up too much space eventually, so you have to take them out. But they're just nice flavoring.
Wow, good ideas.
Yeah, so that's it. Don't try this at home.
No, you are supposed to try it
try
at
this at home.
At home.
All right.
Hi. I'm going to cut the carrots now. So I'm just going to take it off of the greens. And I'm going to make a matchstick cut.
Matchstick?
Matchsticks.
Okay.
So I'm going to start from the end. Do you remember we cut toward the center?
Yep.
Center is very good for balancing your center.
Okay.
So what I'm going to do is start cutting on a diagonal toward the center. Keep my fingers curved. Like this. So I'm cutting diagonals all the way up the carrot. Why is this a matchstick?
Yeah, why is this a matchstick, Julie?
Oh, well, thank you for asking, Dave.
You're welcome.
And remember to use the center part of the carrot, because that's very good for your center. Now, what I'm going to do next, you take a section and you cut that into more sections, and that looks like a matchstick.
Those look like matchsticks.
Yes, that's why this is a matchstick cut.
Yeah.
Now, if you are very good at cutting, instead of taking one section at a time, you can just cut all the way up these sections.
Okay.
And it's much quicker. But you have to be very skilled and careful to do this, because the sections could go flying out. So you have to hold on to them as you're cutting. Isn't that clever?
Very clever.
Yeah. And it makes the dish look very beautiful. You can imagine the carrots and the corn in this boiled salad. It's going to be very beautiful. See how the carrots and the corn are very beautiful together, the colors?
Yes, very nice.
Yes. Very so, you can continue with the how many carrots you want for these two pieces of corn here that we cut. I think I'll use 3 carrots.
Okay. We'll be back after you finish cutting them.
Bye.
Okay. Now we're going to demonstrate that even an amateur like me can cut a carrot. So watch very carefully. I'm going to start off by cutting the carrot on the bias. So.
Are you biased?
I'm biased against the carrot. No, I'm biased in favor of the carrot. I'm going to fold my fingers in like this, because that way when the knife comes down, there's less chance of me cutting my finger off.
Good idea.
Okay, so I don't know whether you can get close enough to see this.
Yeah, we can see that.
Okay.
You're cutting them on a bias.
Yes. And then I'm going to cut right up, and I'm going to include the middle part. I have to hold it up a little bit.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yep. And then, I always do these one at a time, so I'm going to do one cut.
Curve your fingers.
Three cuts. And there are my matchsticks. And I will continue cutting, and you can go have a cup of coffee or something.
I don't drink coffee. I'm macrobiotic.
So, hi, Julie.
Hi, Dave.
Hey, we're going to do the kale now?
Sure.
Okay. You know what? One of the things that always confused me when I first started doing this, people say kale as if it's a vegetable, one kind. And there are a whole bunch of things in the store that are called kale. So, is one better than the other?
We can have different varieties of kale.
Okay.
There are many kinds.
Okay.
We can have red kale. This is dino kale. See the crinkly leaves right here? And in the store, you can just take a look. There are many varieties.
Does it matter which one you cook?
No, just try them all and see which flavors you like.
Okay.
So what I'm going to do is start cutting the kale. Now, like we said earlier, we cut toward the center of the vegetable, like we did here on the carrots. We cut these carrots up toward the center, and we actually included the center in our carrot dish here. See right here? And the center of the carrot and any vegetable is very good for your center and any center of your body. Right here is the center of your arm. That's your joint. This center is very good for your joints and any part of your body that has joints. Your shoulder, your hips. So include that. So I'm going to start cutting the kale toward the center of the plant. Now you don't see the center here because they've taken the leaves off. But what you do is you take a few of the leaves like this. Hold them with your hand and curve your fingers, and then bite-sized pieces. Can you see this? And continue till you get to the end. If the kale has very thick stems, you can save the stems for a broth, or you can chop them up very finely and eat them as well. And continue with the remaining leaves.
Hey, Julie.
Hey, Dave.
What are we up to now?
I'm going to start with a very simple sauce for our boiled salad. Now, we add some parsley. And what I want to talk about is how to make a sauce from very simple ingredients.
Okay.
You can use any kind of herb. Dill, thyme, anything that you like. And what you need is a very simple extra virgin olive oil. I like to get cold pressed.
Why?
And because the heat destroys the oil. You want to make sure that the oil is cold when it's been pressed.
Okay.
This is imported from Italy, so it's very good quality. If you would like to get organic, that's fine too. You don't need to spend a whole lot of money. Just make sure it's extra virgin olive oil, very good quality. So what I'm going to do is, we need to add a little bit of liquid to the blender. So we're going to add a little bit of olive oil. I have some brown rice vinegar. You can use any kind of vinegar that you like. Brown rice vinegar is a little bit more balanced because it's made from a whole grain. This is organic. And you don't have to spend a whole lot of money, just a nice, simple, organic brown rice vinegar. Don't use a whole lot of this because it's very sour. Just a tiny splash will do. You can always adjust the seasonings once it's been blended.
So in other words, it's okay to put more in, but it's really hard to take it out once it's in.
Yes, yes. So I'm going to add some parsley. Now you don't need to add a whole bunch because it becomes very green. But as you can see, I'm eyeballing it. I'm not really following a recipe. I'm just showing you how to make a simple sauce or dressing with very simple ingredients.
Well, for the sake of us people out here who just want a little bit of help, estimate how much olive oil, how much rice vinegar.
I used about a quarter cup of olive oil.
Yep.
And about a tablespoon of brown rice vinegar. This is about 2 cups of parsley here.
Okay.
Add a little bit of salt, so maybe an eighth of a teaspoon. We can always add more later.
Now that's fresh parsley. That's not parsley out of a little can.
That's right. This is all fresh.
Okay.
But this is just very simple, like I said. You can always add more ingredients if you would like to make it fancier. Like if you wanted tahini in it,
okay,
or miso. Okay. I'm going to add some more water because blenders usually, this is about a third, 3/4 of a cup of water. Blenders need a little bit more liquid. If you have a food processor, it doesn't require as much liquid. Now, once you finish blending it, you can taste it. And this is all on what you like. If you like it a little bit thicker, you can add more parsley. So I'm just going to taste it, see if it needs more vinegar or salt. Yes, it needs a little bit more vinegar. I'm just going to put maybe half a teaspoon. And then I want it to be a little bit thicker. As you can see, it's a little bit thin right here. So I'm going to make it thicker by adding more parsley. You can also add some tahini. That would also make it thicker.
What's tahini?
Tahini is a sesame paste ground from sesame seeds. Oh. So I'm adding 2 more cups of parsley. I like to have a thicker sauce. And then just blend.
Where's that sauce coming, Julie?
Well, I've already blended 4 cups of parsley.
Okay.
So what I'm going to do now is taste it, see if it needs, see how thick it got?
No, mix it a little bit so we can see. Show it in the spoon. Oh yeah, okay.
Yeah, it's like a pesto. It would be very good on noodles, actually. But what I'm going to do is just taste it. Good. Needs a little bit of salt.
Here, let me try.
Here.
No, just give me the spoon. That's fine. Oh, it is nice.
Yeah, this needs a little bit of salt. I'm just going to add a little bit of salt, blend it a tiny, tiny bit.
Yeah.
A little bit more salt. So as you can see, when you're making a dressing or a sauce, you just need simple ingredients. And you can always add more of the ingredients later. Ready to go.
Good. Looks green. That is a nice sauce, Julie. Tastes kind of plain to me because I have spicy taste. Could I have just put in like a couple of cloves of garlic in spice that up and just mix it all in?
Yes. This I showed you something using a simple ingredient. If you wanted to make it fancy, like I said, you could add tahini, miso in place of the salt.
Okay. Shoyu.
Shoyu in place of the salt and herbs or spices. If you
Peppers?
Yeah, peppers.
Mm-hmm. This is sounding better and better.
Well, yes. If you're healthy, if you don't have a health condition, that would be fine. Hi.
Hi. Okay. We're back, Julie. What's going on?
Well, the rice is done.
Oh, good.
So I just wanted to show you what the rice looks like.
Okay. Oh, it looks like rice.
Yes. Wow. Yeah, always mix up the bottom and top rice to get energy of the bottom and the top. As you can see, the rice on the bottom is darker because it's closer to the flame.
It's like crusty. Nice.
Yes.
Mm. Yep.
And then when it's done, transfer it to a glass dish.
Okay.
And it's ready to serve.
That was easy.
Yeah. And the beans are also done.
Wow. Okay.
So.
Some people might ask, so I'm going to ask, Julie.
Yes.
We're in a kitchen here. Why are you cooking on a Coleman stove?
Well, you have, Dave, an electric stove which came with your apartment.
Aha.
Electricity has very chaotic energy. It's hard to control the heat.
Uh-huh.
The flame is much easier to control. And flame has a much more steady warming energy. And you can taste it when you cook your food over a flame versus an electric stove. Fire is the energy of transformation. Phoenix rose out of fire, not out of electricity. So spiritually, you would have healing qualities in the food if you cook it over a flame versus on an electric stove.
All right.
So if you have an electric stove, you can get one of these Coleman propane stoves, and that way your food would have much better healing qualities to it.
But given that most people are not going to go to all that trouble, we're good with our electric stoves until we can get gas stoves,
yeah,
correct?
When you can get the gas stove, that would be better.
All right.
Now I'm going to strain the beans.
Okay.
Here. Mm-hmm. See the kombu?
Wait a second. Yes?
Okay. Now you can, if you can eat a lot more minerals, if you need more minerals because of your health condition,
yeah. You
can eat the kombu. If you have too many minerals because of a high meat diet or a high salt diet, then you don't need to eat the kombu. Take out the kombu, and you can use it for another dish.
Okay, so a rule of thumb, if you're a meat eater, you don't need the kombu.
No, you don't.
Okay, and if you're a vegan, hang on to that kombu.
Yeah. It's very healing for you. Yeah. Now I'm just going to season the beans.
Okay.
Now, you suggested putting scallions.
Yes, I did.
Yeah, that was your idea.
Yes, I did. What a great idea.
So what I'm going to do is add some scallions to our beans here.
Okay.
Now we can season it in many ways. I think I will season the beans with ume plum vinegar.
Oh, what's that?
This is the juice that comes from making ume plums. Ume plums are a healing macrobiotic plum. It's preserved, pickled, and it's very alkalinizing.
Okay.
So ume plum vinegar has a salty taste to it. So you don't need to add any salt if you use this. So I'm just gonna add a dash of ume plum vinegar, and then toasted sesame oil also will add some flavor because the sesame flavor will be very nice for this. And I'm using the toasted sesame oil because oil is more balanced when you cook it. So if you're going to add the oil after the beans are cooked, then it's better to add the toasted one because the oil's already been cooked. Mm-hmm. So I'm just mixing it up like this. And let's taste it, see if it needs some more seasoning. It's good. I think it needs a little bit more ume vinegar. It needs a tiny bit more salt. Would you like to taste, Dave?
Yeah, I would. Yep, I would.
You really taste the
salt. The other thing that I hear you saying is that you have to just use kind of your judgment on
your intuition,
seasoning. You know,
does
it
taste?
Look over here. Does it taste good?
Oh,
no,
yes.
I think it needs something more. And then you just trust your judgment and you put it in.
Yeah, don't add too much all at once. It's better to add more later. So.
Okay. There goes your cell phone, Julie.
That's not mine, that's yours.
Oh, okay.
Would you like to taste?
Yes. Hi.
Hi.
Well, what's up today?
Well, we're going to boil our vegetables.
Oh, okay. What do we got?
We got corn and carrots and kale. Now,
okay.
When we do our boiled salad, We're going to start with the least flavorful vegetable, which is the corn. And we're going to boil the corn and then strain it and then boil the carrots in the same water. That way we don't waste the water. So, I'm going to put the corn in. And that'll take about 5 minutes. Meanwhile, we can blanch our kale.
Blanch? What's blanch?
Blanching means to quickly boil the kale with the lid off. As you can see, the water is boiling, and I'm going to put the kale in. Blanching has upward rising energy, and of course you know upward rising energy is good for the heart. So the kale will take only about 3 minutes. Oh, hi.
Hi.
Well, the vegetables are done. As you can see, the kale has been cooking for 3 minutes, and you know when it's done when it turns dark green and it's tender but it still has a bite to it.
I always do better when I just time it, because I can't tell dark green from green.
Okay, timing works too.
Yeah. But the one thing that I always remember is that right now, people don't realize this, I didn't, that is still cooking.
Yes,
so it's a good idea to take it out a little bit before it feels exactly the way you want it.
Yes, because if you take it out right, right at the time it's done, it's still cooking.
Right.
Now also, do not cover your greens, because if you cover your greens, you'll keep the steam in and the greens will cook even more. So just take the greens off the stove and don't cover them. Now we're going to strain the corn, but we're going to keep the water. See that? Doesn't that smell good?
Yeah. Are we going to drink the water or make soup out of it or what?
This water is going to be used to cook the carrots, which are over here.
Oh, I see.
So we're going to put this back on the stove.
I thought you were talking before about not mixing flavors.
Yes, we want to keep each vegetable separate. So we cook it separately and we can... However, we can reuse the water if we start with the least flavorful vegetable first. That way, the water won't be so flavored when we add the carrots or the second vegetable. So I'm going to add the carrots and let that boil for about 3 minutes. Been about 3 minutes. They are just tender, but they still have a bite to them. And all we're going to do is strain them in a strainer. See how orange they are?
Oh yeah, they're nice.
And all we do is mix up the corn and the carrots.
Okay, let me take a look at this. Oh, nice colors.
Yeah. Mix them up and they're ready to eat.
Okay. Oh good, so we're all ready to eat?
Yeah.
Well, let's eat.
Eat.
All right.